Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Newcraigs Evangelical Church. My name is Rob Weir, and I'm one of the elders here in the church. It's my job today to guide us through the service that we have for you. Just over a year ago, we heard the term COVID-19 for the first time. And who would have thought that a year on, it would have come to dominate our lives in the way it has? But dominate, it certainly has. And we are still affected by it and battling against it. It's good that the vaccine is now starting to be rolled out, but because we are trying to conform to the advice and the regulations to keep us all safe, we are conducting the service from our own homes today rather than going into the church building. We have a varied programme for you nonetheless, and we do hope that you enjoy it. I also want to just make mention of our appreciation for our music team. Over the months, they have really put themselves out to record both old songs and new songs, and sometimes old songs in new settings, for our benefit and the benefit of the church. I want to make mention too that we're also indebted to Alistair McLaughlin down in London, but he has a crucial part to play in pulling the music all together. Once it's been recorded by the singers and the instrumentalists, it goes down to London and he does his magic on the technical side to produce it, to mix it, so that it comes out and makes sense. We have a new song that the band have done for us today, and we hope that you enjoy it. It's called The Goodness of God.
Running after me. pray. Our God, we come before your throne with our prayers, because it is you alone who was, who is, and who is to come. These are the words you spoke to John as he prayed from his exile on Patmos, and so we too take the opportunity to rest in your supernatural greatness. Lord, it is you who is the Alpha and the Omega. To you time is no mystery and death is no match. In your presence, darkness is impossible, and the greatest terrors this world contains all scurry away and hide. All eyes will one day see you and cling to you or flee from you. With a word, you created life itself, and with a breath, you tell oceans to be still. You know the number of the stars, and they declare your glory with every photon of light. The angels sing and the demons tremble. Lord, how can we do anything but fall down in awe and praise? And yet how insecure we often feel, how preoccupied with life we have become. Forgive us and move us, Lord, to a greater plane of worship. Yes, our feet are in the miry clay, but you can lift us up onto the rock to stay. Forgive our sins and lift us once again onto the rock of Christ Jesus our Lord, who embodies all your splendour, grace, power and love, and gifts it to his children. To the Lord who gave us himself, we ask that you would now, once again, refresh our spirits, guide our hearts and minds, and give us hope.
We pray for our brothers and sisters across the world who are suffering great hardship, but who find blessing in the things we take for granted. We pray for those such as the Rohingya refugees fleeing violence in Myanmar to arrive in camps in Bangladesh. They have hope that they can live their lives safe and free from violence. They praise God that thanks to a Tear Fund partner organisation, there are now 463 solar-powered lights to make the streets of these camps safer, especially for women, teenage girls and children. We give thanks to God for the hope he's brought to many communities across the world in the form of reliable water sources. We praise God that we can read about a rural village in northeast Brazil, which after years of intense drought, now have a dam which allows them to irrigate their land and produce crops all year round to feed their families. We pray that you will equip the church to respond to the needs of communities across the world in giving them hope on this earth as well as in the life to come. We pray for those in our own country struggling and feeling hopeless. Perhaps life has been dramatically changed by sudden unemployment and anxiety over having enough money to support their families. We pray that they will seek comfort in knowing that the God of all hope cares for them and can intervene in their own individual circumstances. We also pray for our church. Father God, we pray in hope that the gospel shines from Newcraigs more brightly in a dark situation. We ask that you fill us with the hope of salvation and use us to bring the good news to others in our community. Amen.
I think I may have mentioned to a number of people how much I am enjoying a book that I got for Christmas. It's called Gentle and Lowly by Dane Ortlund. Adam has got it as well, and he's recommending it. It's a book that talks about what the heart of Jesus is really like. The book is centred round one particular passage in Matthew. Let me just read it to you. Matthew 11, 28 to 30. Come to me, all you who labour and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Just one wee excerpt from the book to give you a wee flavour of it. And I thoroughly recommend you get a hold of this book. His yoke is kind, and his burden is light. That is, his yoke is a non-yoke, and his burden is a non-burden. What helium does to a balloon, Jesus' yoke does to his followers. We are buoyed along in life by his endless gentleness and supremely accessible lowliness. He doesn't simply meet us at our place of need. He lives in our place of need. He never tires of sweeping us into his tender embrace. It is his very heart. It is what gets him out of bed in the morning. Just a flavour of some real gems in this book, Gentle and Lowly. Now we're going to sing another song, Majesty.
Baking?
Because it brings me joy. Seb, why do you always listen to that song?
Because it brings me joy. Freddie, why have you still got your Christmas hat on? Oh, because it brings you joy. Why do you have so many flowers?
Because
because they bring me joy.
Why are you guys playing football?
Because it brings me joy! Why are you watching that video again?
Because it brings me joy. Come and see.
I'm just going to get this biscuit out of the tin. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to place this biscuit in front of you, Freddy. And I don't want you to eat it until I get back, okay? Good boy.
Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God.
That's amazing. What passage is that?
It's Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 to 3.
Why did he choose that one?
Because it's about Jesus. He's our true joy.
There you go, Max. A nice drink. Oh, I'm really looking forward to giving my friend some of the brownie I made tonight. Seb, why are you eating all the brownie?
Because it's delicious.
Oh, I thought the theme of this video was joy.
Oh, yeah, it is. Oh, yeah, that was good brownie. There's lots of things that bring us joy in this life, isn't there? You've seen the things that bring Megan and I joy. I wonder what brings you joy. But when we think about it, the things that bring us joy in this life don't last forever, do they? And let's face it, life isn't that joyful right now. But Jesus, well, he's the true joy. Jesus can give joy that lasts forever. In the reading that we read from Hebrews, we read that Jesus died for our sins. That means that when we've done wrong things and we've made God upset at the wrong things we've done, if we ask Jesus to forgive us, he can and he will. And that can give us joy. We can forget about those wrong things. We don't have to feel guilty anymore. And even in the darkest times in life, if we put our trust in Jesus, we can have joy. And you know why? Because Jesus has promised that everyone who follows him will have joy that lasts forever. One day, we will go and live with Jesus in paradise, in heaven, forever. Now that is true joy.
A big thank you to Sebastian and Megan for that brilliant children's talk. Now we're going to have one more tremendous song before Joe Dowdle reads the passage for today, and then Adam is going to preach.
Jesus Christ. 14-21. And Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit to Galilee, and a report about him went out through all the surrounding country, and he taught in their synagogues, being glorified by all. And he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And as was his custom, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, and he stood up to read. And the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favour." And he rolled up the scroll and gave it back to the attendant and sat down. And the eyes of all in the synagogue were fixed on him. And he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 to 3. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured from sinners such hostility against himself, so that you may not grow weary or faint-hearted.
Good morning. Let me add my welcome to Rob's welcome to Church Online. Why don't you turn back to Luke chapter 4 and also Hebrews chapter 12 as we look at the subject this morning of the joy ahead as we step into this new year, but also the joy that we can find in the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's what I want to remind us of this morning. In 1889, Vincent van Gogh gave one of his paintings to his good friend, Dr. Felix Ray. It was a portrait of Dr. Ray, and he was delighted to receive it. His mother was delighted to receive it, but not for the same reasons. She didn't actually care much for the painting. In fact, she didn't like it at all. But she thought, I've got a hole in my chicken coop in my back garden where the foxes have tried to get in and steal and kill my chickens. And this is just what I need to plug the gap. And I know it's hard to believe because that painting is now estimated to be worth $50 million and it hangs pride of place in the Pushkin Museum in Moscow. But for the first few years, it plugged a hole in a chicken coop in Dr. Felix Ray's mum's back garden. But you see, I think as Christians, we can be a bit like that with the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. And as we start into 2021, I want us to grasp again that the gospel is the hope for our lives. And it is the hope that we bring to the hearts of the people in Kirkcaldy. Because in one sense, it's not just about saying, you know, it's 2021. Thank goodness 2020 is over. This year is going to be so different. Because in one sense, it's just the change of a date on a calendar. Nothing has actually changed. And we're already continuing to experience the prolonged lockdown of the COVID pandemic. In fact, I was slightly amused and amazed at an advert being put out by Ryanair. Have you seen it? It's with the tagline, jab and go. In other words, the vaccine is here, so book your summer holidays. We've got the vaccine, the virus is going to be gone, and we're going to start to live our lives again. Because in reality, our biggest problems, the Bible teaches us, are not external, but they're internal. The Bible doesn't just talk about social distancing. It talks about the social distance between us and God. And you know when you've tried to read the Bible and you think, I don't even get what this is saying. Or you try and pray and it's like you're shouting words at the ceiling. That kind of social distance doesn't get changed by the date changing. It gets changed by the gospel. You see, we can talk about the gospel as though it's simply the message of how you get your sins forgiven. And it is that, of course it is. And that's vital in the way that it was very important for Dr. Felix Ray's mum's chickens not to be eaten by the fox. It's important, but the gospel is so much more than that. Jesus says in John chapter 10, verse 10, I've come to give you life and life to the full. And that's more than just being forgiven. That's about a whole new you. It says in Galatians 5 verse 1, it is for freedom that Christ has set you free. And so often we can talk about being forgiven for our sins a lot more than being set free from our sins. You see, the truth is, if lockdown is a thing of history, and then we go about our daily routines and business and yet act as though nothing has happened, and yet we're still imprisoned on the inside, what use is that? If we're still imprisoned by the fact that we're driven by our own emotions, we get so down or we feel so lonely, or we're imprisoned by our own bad habits and addictions, or we're messed up when it comes to our relationships with others, what's the point in being able to socialize freely if we know that there's something still damaging our relationships with one another? And yet the gospel truth is that Jesus has come and he has lived the life that we should have lived. He's died the death that we should have died, and he's risen again. He's ascended back to his Father in heaven for something much bigger beyond yours and mine, forgiveness of sin. Forgiveness is so important. It's the entry point to the joy of knowing God, but it's the means to a wonderful new life that we can enjoy now with God through the gospel. And so that is the thing that sets us free. And so to find 2021 to be a totally different year will be because we have a totally different grasp of the gospel. And so this morning, I want to look at the joy ahead. Did you notice in the second reading that Joe read for us, Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 2, it said it was for the joy that was set before him. The joy that was set before Jesus, he endured the cross. Not for the forgiveness that was set before him, but the joy that was set before him. Jesus saw the joy that you and I would experience through the gospel, and he was delighted, and he wants us to be delighted as well. And my prayer is that this will help us take the gospel painting out of the chicken coop, to dust it down, and to realize, perhaps for the first time, that it is far more valuable than we had realized before. So as we look at Luke chapter 4, I think this might be a good place to start. We've read these words before as we went through Luke's gospel and as we've looked at the book of Acts recently. Luke chapter 4 and verses 14 to 21. This has often been referred to as Jesus' ministry manifesto or his mission mandate. It's actually Jesus' first sermon that's recorded for us. Jesus comes to the synagogue at Nazareth. The attendant hands Jesus the scroll for that day. It happens to be from the prophet Isaiah. And Jesus chooses to read from what we now have as Isaiah chapter 61 and verses 1 and 2. And he reads it out to the people. And he says, "This is why I've really come." And you will know if you've truly understood the gospel by whether this manifesto summarizes whether you believe this is what your life is meant to be in Jesus Christ. And he says this, verse 18, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he," God the Father, "has anointed me." You see, that's what the gospel is all about. In fact, in Galatians chapter 3, verse 14, it summarizes the gospel as the promise of being filled with the Holy Spirit. Now, the Bible uses different ways to describe this. Jesus says here that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He says, "God the Father has anointed me." In 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17, it says that the Holy Spirit himself has united himself with our spirit so that God has made his home in us. That's what Christianity is about. It's not just about somehow getting cleaned up and forgiven. It's about entering a whole new life with God, where God dwells on the inside and changes us from the inside out. So Jesus says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me to proclaim good news." And here again is how you tell whether you've grasped the gospel. You know, sometimes the gospel is shared with people and it's shared like this: "You've sinned. God is angry, but it's okay. God sent his son to die for you. He's decided if you say sorry that he will forgive you," which is good news. It's amazing good news, but it can also sound like bad news. When you tell someone they're a sinner, when someone tells you that God is angry with you, when someone makes you feel bad in the name of Christianity, it can lead to good. You know, unless we understand the bad news of our condition, we will never appreciate the good news of God's promise of provision in Christ. But it can also really feel like bad news. You see, Jesus says, "I've come to bring good news." And he goes on to proclaim how great a savior God is. He says, "I've come to bring good news to the poor." And I find this so encouraging. You know, we can take it as those who are materially poor, but it's also talking about those who are spiritually poor. He says at the beginning of his famous sermon, the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 5, "Blessed are the poor in spirit. Those are the ones who will see the kingdom of God." So can you see it's good news? Because it's not about God coming and saying, "Come on now, try harder in 2021. It's not like those New Year's resolutions that perhaps you made at the beginning of the year that, well, for me anyway, they're usually broken by the end of the first week of January. And that's because we don't have the power to change ourselves from the outside in. But Jesus says, the Spirit of the Lord is on me to bring good news to the poor. And now it's not about you, it's about God coming and living inside you and changing you from the inside out. This reminds me of the words of Matthew chapter 9 and verses 12 and 13. Jesus is with a group of Pharisees, the religious leaders, and he says, I haven't come to help those who think they're healthy. I've come to help those who admit that they're sick. I haven't come to help those who think they're really righteous with God. I've come to help those who know that they're sinners. I haven't come to ask people to bring grand sacrifices. I've come to offer people undeserved mercy. You see, the good news about the Christian message is that it's not about God wanting to just clean up our act. It's about God bringing us new life in Christ by giving his Spirit to live in us and to flow out of us. And then that will totally transform us and the world around us. And so Jesus continues, he has sent me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim liberty to the captives, freedom to the prisoners, and recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Don't you want 2021 to be the year of the Lord's favor? Well, the good news is this, it is. Just like every year since Jesus died and rose again and ascended to heaven, and he sent his Spirit, because it's not about us anymore, it's about him. So can you see that what Jesus proclaims in this first sermon is far bigger than just forgiveness? That is the first thing we need to admit, our need of a savior. We need to admit that we are poor and imprisoned, that we are blind, that we are oppressed. And so we need God's undeserved favor. And as we admit those things, God then says, I will come and I will transform you. God says to us, you can go into 2021 looking forward to the joy ahead, because through Jesus, your life can be totally different this year. And I believe that that is what God is saying to us as individuals, but also as a church. He's saying in the sense that it's time to stop your chicken coop Christianity and to discover the true beauty of the gospel picture. That as the Holy Spirit transforms our hearts, he sets us free so that we're no longer socially distanced from God, but we can really commune with God and know him better. As his word flows into our minds to help us think the way that God thinks, to have our minds transformed, even to reject the lies of the evil one that messes up our lives and our thinking. He flows out into our emotions and into the center of our hearts and lives, and overflowing out into our attitudes, and even dealing with the baggage that we're still carrying into 2021. I love the way the Authorized Version puts parts of these verses. It uses the phrase that Jesus has come to bind up the brokenhearted. And many are beginning 2021 somewhat brokenhearted. But God the Father says, through the Spirit of my Son, I want to transform your heart, your mind, your body, your soul, your will, so that you can say, my life is now being lived for God. These hands, these feet are now for God, as God's Spirit uses God's word to give wisdom and direction to make a difference in this world wherever I go. And so can you see that we can be excited about 2021, not because the date has changed, not even because 2020 wasn't the year that we wanted, but because Jesus says here, enough of this chicken coop Christianity. Enough of just settling for the gospel, bringing you forgiveness and nothing more. The gospel brings you transformation. Because as the writer to the Hebrews tells us of Jesus, it was for the joy that was set before me that I came and lived and died and rose and ascended back to my Father in heaven for the joy so that I could now set this joy before you. We are not Dr. Felix Ray's mother. We are not going to be those who just take the gospel and use it to plug a hole in the chicken coop. It's about forgiveness, but it's more than that as we experience more of what God has got for us in 2021. You know, I guess your experience of growing up in church life I guess some of my experience of church life is that we were left with the impression that joy and enjoyment weren't always the first words that sprung to mind. And maybe even the experience has been one of guilt and a lot of shame and perhaps with that a lot of drivenness, but with a sense of failure. And perhaps as you think about your past life, all sorts of emotions come to the surface. Maybe disappointment comes to mind. There is joy and enjoyment, there has to have been, but perhaps they're not the first words that come to mind. And yet when I read Jesus' great manifesto, when you read Luke chapter 4, it's got joy written all over it. And this is what I want us to experience this coming year together. So I guess we need to ask the question, what is it that stops us? What is it that hinders us? And I guess I want to bring you three simple things. You will probably be able to think of others. But as we step into this joy that lies ahead of us, I think for me, the three things are this, that kind of distract us from what we read of in Luke 4. And I think the first one is this, that so often I get distracted by my failures. You see, I think for some of us, we've stopped looking at God and what he brings, and we've started to look at ourselves. And yet that's why it's so helpful that Jesus' sermon begins. Just listen to the first seven or eight words. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Jesus says in just a few words, this is what the essence of God is all about. It's actually the Trinity. Did you notice it's the Spirit of the Lord? God the Father is on me. God the Son. Jesus says this freedom is all about shifting our eyes off ourselves and onto him. Whereas as chicken coop Christianity is all about becoming self-absorbed. And yet what do we read in Hebrews 12 verse 2? It's for the joy that was set before him. Jesus died. And that verse follows on from verse 1, which talks about fixing our eyes on Jesus. It says, therefore, let's throw off everything that hinders, all these obstacles, the distractions of my own failures. Let's throw off the sin, the writer says, that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race that is marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. And that's what I want to do this year. As I say, Jesus, you started a work in me, and what you start, you always finish, because you are the pioneer and perfecter of my faith. I'm so sorry, Jesus, that I fixed my eyes on me. I want to fix my eyes on you instead. The second thing that distracts us, I think, is our strength, which sounds ironic. It's the opposite of failures, we might think. But actually, it's the other side of the same coin. Pride has two sides, just as self-centeredness has two sides. So when you think too much of yourself, and when things go wrong, what happens? You get discouraged and you get down. When you think too much of yourself and things go right, what happens? You get puffed up in your own eyes. And both of those are a reason why we don't perhaps experience what God has for us more than we do. And when I look back on 2020 and what God has tried to teach us, I think what I've noticed is that God has systematically taken away those things that we think make us feel strong. And yet, I'm actually thankful for the way that God has taken away some of our experiences, even last year. Even the things that have forced us to clear our diaries, to focus more on him and not on ourselves. And although we've been in lockdown physically, perhaps this has brought freedom in a way of thinking about the life changes that need to happen and the clearer sightedness that we need as we go into this year, as maybe we begin again fixing our eyes on him and the joy that lies ahead of us if we keep our eyes fixed on him. And so one of the reasons we don't experience this is that we get puffed up in pride and we start thinking, actually, I'm not poor, I'm not blind, I'm not oppressed, I don't need God's favor. And Jesus says, actually, the good news only comes to those who will admit that they need me. And 2020 has been a year of us being stripped back so that this year we can fix our eyes on Jesus and the joy that lies ahead. Because I think the third thing that distracts us is our busyness. Did you notice that when Jesus preaches in the synagogue in Nazareth, he doesn't immediately then go back to heaven, job done? No, he stays and he spends 3 years explaining these things to his disciples before he deals with the ultimate reality of securing our salvation at the cross and completing that good news because of the joy that was set before him. And so you'll remember, whilst he's with them, he tells them the parable in Matthew 13. He talks about the parable of the sower. It was the passage that Alan McKnight spoke from a few weeks ago. And the parable is about four different types of soil, which represents the four different ways in which our hearts can respond to the gospel word. You see, there's no lack of power in the seed in this gospel, a gospel which Paul will go on to say is bearing fruit all over the world, but it might not be bearing much fruit in our lives if we're not careful. And so let's listen to what Jesus says. He says the first type of soil is sown on the path where the word never really takes hold. As soon as it's sown, the birds of the air snatch it away. It's like the person who attends the online service and listens to the word of God, turns it off and remains completely unaffected by what has been said. And then the second type of soil Jesus mentions is really the shallow soil. It's the rocky soil. Again, there's nothing wrong with the seed. There's just not enough for the plant to take root and to grow. And then we don't want to be like the seed that falls amongst the thorns. Jesus says, that's like the person who's so busy with so much stuff and the cares of this life just take over and choke us. But it's because they never make time for the word of God to go deep into their lives. And can I say that when we do get back to church life in some shape or form, that's why it's important for us to think through that not everything that went into the box at the start of 2020 needs to come out again. But our weekly online services are so important for us to keep on growing as Christians, and our week by week growth groups are so important to put in our diaries for each week. And that's why we're encouraging you to read God's word. Maybe get a copy of Tim Keller's The Way of Wisdom. So as you journey through the book of Proverbs and the New Testament, as you journey with God this year, we don't want to be like the path or the rocky soil or the thorny soil. And Jesus says, if we sort those things, you will be like the good soil. It will grow 30, 60, 100 times what was sown. And you will experience more of the joy ahead of you in 2021. Because this morning, can we say that we are going to fix our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith? Are we going to believe that what Jesus has begun, he is going to finish? He is going to complete that work in us. And are we going to believe that God wants us to take Luke chapter 4 and he's going to do that in our lives, that he wants to change us so that when we reconnect with our friends in 2021, they will see something different about us. And we'll be able to proclaim the gospel message to them as well. As we finish, I just want to remind us of the words that we find in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old is gone. The new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. And as Jesus endured the cross for the joy that was set before him, let's make Jesus our joy as we step into this new year. Amen.
My righteousness and freedom, I stand.
you, Adam, for that very thoughtful and challenging message to us all today. Let's just close in a time of prayer. Our Father, we thank you for being with us today, for leading us and guiding us. And we thank you, Lord, for your word and for Adam presenting it to us. We pray that we would pay heed to the message and rise to the challenge that he has given us. We ask your blessing now on us as we part, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all for being with us today. If there's something that has challenged you or you want to speak to us or contact us about, please refer to the link for the website on the screen at the end of our broadcast. Thank you all again. God bless.